Ainda sobre esta questão, Ontário é considerado um hub para o tráfico humano, onde pelo menos 55% do tráfico humano do país acontece na província de Ontário. Para melhor entender as mais recentes leis adicionadas ao projeto de investimento de 307 milhões de dólares em ações de combate ao tráfico humano do governo de Ontário, estive à conversa com Jill Dunlop, ministra adjunta das Crianças e dos Assuntos das Mulheres. Ora veja.
Joining us here today is Associate Minister of Children and Women's Issues, Jill Dunlop. Minister Dunlop, thank you so much for being here with us today.
Well, thank you very much for having me.
There has been a recent legislation acts and amendments added to the already existing Ontario's anti-human trafficking strategy. And I'm just going to say this for the ones at home who haven't heard about these new additions. These are acts and amendments that are part of a $307 million investment from the Ontario's government in efforts to combat human trafficking in the province. And also it's the largest investment in the country on this subject so far. So unfortunately, Ontario is considered a hub for human trafficking, where at least 55% of the country's human trafficking happens in Ontario. So one can only agree that this is obviously significantly high number for the province. And I would like to start off with the understanding first, the root of the problem. Why is Ontario a hub for this type of crime, and what makes it a convenient place, if I might say that, for human trafficking?
Well, thank you, Teresa. That's a very good question. And as you mentioned, we introduced legislation yesterday, and Ontario will be the first province in Canada to introduce this type of legislation. So I'm very proud of my team and the work that our government has done, and thank all of the frontline workers, survivors, and organizations who support human trafficker victims who came forward to help in the consultations as we put this plan together. You know, unfortunately, Ontario is a hub for human trafficking in this province. And, you know, we have a very large population in Ontario, which is one factor, you know, many cities being very close to, you know, like the GTA, but also, you know, our geographical place compared to the US, right? We have the US border points in many areas, and also just the fact that, you know, there's no federal boundaries across Canada. So it's very easy to traffic victims through the area. We know the 400 series highways is also a likely area where victims are trafficked. So we've done a lot of work with the Ministry of Transportation as well, looking at on routes and truck stops to how we can ensure there's better lighting, better video surveillance in those areas to ensure that we're doing everything we can to help victims.
I would like to ask what, in regards to the next steps that Ontario is making to combat the human trafficking in a province, I'd like to know what are the first and foremost steps that we need to make next.
Well, as I mentioned, our first step was in consultations with frontline service providers, and, you know, more importantly, with survivors to really understand what their needs were in developing a strategy for the province and ensuring that the funding that would be available would be in the right areas to protect those victims. We stabilized funding. That was something we'd heard from frontline organizations, that they really needed to be ensured that the money was going to be there every year for them. So we stabilized that funding. We announced the strategy last March, just prior to COVID, with myself and the Solicitor General. So it really shows the fact that, you know, the strategy is about supporting victims and survivors and holding offenders accountable, because one is really reliant on the other. We expanded the funding just recently with the Community Supports Funding and Indigenous-Led Initiatives Fund, and also the legislation that we announced yesterday. But more work is happening. You know, it is a five-year strategy, and part of the legislation calls for the government to continue with the strategy moving forward. So it will be, you know, ongoing conversations with consultations along the way.
When it comes to holding people accountable, what are the next steps being taken in regards to that?
Will there be a lot of work done with the hotel and motel? And, you know, I applaud them already for the work that they've been doing to educate their staff members to look for the signs of human trafficking that, you know, we know are happening in hotels across the province, as well as looking at Airbnbs too. So including or expanding what they're doing with their guest registry lists, and also the collaboration between the hotels and the police officers as well, so that we can ensure that they're getting the information that they need if there is a suspected case of human trafficking. So you know, that's one area with that sector that is has been great work. And the you know, also with the Ministry of the Attorney General, we're expanding the restraining orders further than 3 years right now. So that will be, again, additional supports for the survivors.
Okay, so now changing the subject, just one last question. In regards to women's affairs, there has been recent studies showing that entrepreneur women and their businesses have it harder than men during this pandemic here in Canada. Do you have, or do you know of any ongoing plans to tackle this issue?
Well, we do recognize that the pandemic has disproportionately affected women, and women tend to be the caregivers at home too. So, you know, not only are women, you know, in some cases have lost their job, but they're also have, you know, at times we're home with the children teaching as well and being caregivers. So it has had that disproportionate impact, but we've had the opportunity to meet with many amazing women across the province through the virtual roundtables that we were doing. I was happy to host one of those tables in Ottawa and hear from entrepreneurial women about the impacts that it had on their business and working from home, taking their business online in some cases for the first time. But we have the small business grant program in place, and I do encourage women, anyone, to ensure that they're looking into those supports, because they are there to support small business and at this time, because you know, we do recognize that it's a difficult time. The work that our Minister of Education has been doing with childcare and the supports for learners grants too. There was three calls for those for $200 for each child up to the age of 12. And then it was expanded to include high school students as well. So those have been well received. And, you know, just listening to the public and having a better understanding of where the supports can be in place.
All right, thank you so much. That is it for today. I would like to thank you for being here with us today.
Great, thank you so much. You too.
Thank you so much. Take care.